650 AM WSM, sharing it with you around the world at WSMonline.com. And when I say sharing, what indeed a pleasure it is to be able to share some mic time with an iconic voice in not just American music, but the music of the world. He's known for his high-pitched singing voice. The Guinness Book of World Records cites him as the second most successful songwriter behind Paul McCartney, of all things. He's had over a 50-year career, a member of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, a 1997 inductee into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with the Bee Gees, and only Elvis Presley, the Beatles, Michael Jackson, and Paul McCartney have outsold the group the Bee Gees. We're delighted to speak with the founding member of that organization from his home in Miami, Mr. Barry Gibb. Barry, welcome to WSM.
Thank you, Eddie. That was wonderful. Keep talking.
You've got quite a pedigree, you know that?
No, I haven't heard it spelled out like that, but it's pretty amazing.
Well,
thank you.
Well, thank you, sir. Thank you for allowing us the privilege of some chat time here today, because
I know
you don't do interviews very often, and what a privilege it is to speak with you.
I do. I don't enjoy them very often. How's that?
Well, you've laughed several times, so...
Yeah, right.
That's a good lick for both of us. As music progresses and time progresses, your music has continued to cross multiple boundaries between rock, soul, pop, disco, and country. And really, over the years, we've seen the lines get blurrier and blurrier, which has really been beneficial because it's allowed so many more people to come together from multiple genres and embrace the musical styles of someone such as yourself. And for those who may not know this, you're a big fan of country music and traditional country music especially.
Oh, yeah. Only in the last few years fell really deeply for bluegrass music. I don't know how it came about. I think there was an attraction with my wife and myself into purchasing the Johnny Cash home, you know, a few years back. Because I think we were just in love with Johnny Cash. We were in love with the house, and I wanted to be somewhere where I could be surrounded by music, where I might be able to write with other people and have that home to go to in Nashville, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't pan out, of course, because the fire took the house. But in doing so, it laid a path for me to meet people like Ricky Skaggs and the gentleman who lived next door.
Oh, Marty Stewart and Connie
Marty,
Smith.
Marty and all the different people in country music and bluegrass music that I've had the honor of shaking the hands. Like Gillian Welch, who said, when it goes in real deep. That's how it felt. I felt like I was falling in love.
I tell you, there's no substitute for substance, and people are starved for substance. There's so much substance in the music that you have contributed over the years.
Oh.
But you talk about bluegrass, that's one of the most traditional forms of country music.
The immigrant music, the music that came out of Ireland and Scotland and ended up in the Appalachians and places like Jerusalem Ridge. This was a calling for me. We all have that voice inside, you know. And that voice says, you know, not that way, that way. and I was at a time in my life where I didn't know which way, you know. And the voice said, that way. And I've written country songs all my life and didn't know how to tell myself that that's what I love more than anything else. And it goes back to bluegrass, immigrant music, all of these things. They just compel me. I can't explain it any other way.
Well, one of the great performers in bluegrass music, one of the architects of the genre, was Earl Scruggs, the great banjo player. Earl made a statement one time that I quote him on almost every day, and he said, "The beauty of simplicity will never be surpassed." And that can apply to so many things in life, but especially music. And last year, you were in town, and you appeared as a surprise guest of Ricky Skaggs on stage at the Ryman Auditorium, the mother church of country music.
That's right, that's right.
And you went out and sang with him and accompanied by his band. You had early recorded Soldier's Son with Ricky for his project, Music to My Ears. It was like the roof came off of that place when he walked out there.
First of all, the Ryman is sacred ground. When you get to play in there and it doesn't get better, there is nowhere better, you know? And you're on the stage where hundreds, thousands of artists have stood, you know, from Elvis to Roy Orbison to Willie to, you know, everybody has stood in that place and sang. And the acoustics are unbelievable. We just sucked it in that night. It was magic for us. It was just magic for us. What a beautiful, beautiful place.
Was that your first time to appear at the Ryman?
First time at the Ryman was with Olivia Newton-John.
Wow.
And about a year or so before that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Only the best get to come to the Ryman.
Well, yeah, they got the best audiences, too.
Well, the next night, July 27th, 2012,
yeah. Right.
was a Friday night. You made your Grand Ole Opry debut, and you sang three songs that night.
Right.
And I tell you, it was what we refer to at the Opry backstage as an Opry moment. You had the audience on your side, without a doubt. But, you know, when the wings are filled up with the performers on the bill that night, as
yeah.
well as their accompanying musicians, that doesn't happen too often, Barry.
Oh, I see what you mean. No, well, that's very kind. That's very kind. And it was a wonderful experience. And I thought that was sort of something that happened all the time. I'm a little shocked because I didn't realize that.
Well, you're getting to come back to Nashville. You're going to be back on the Opry, on the Tuesday night Opry,
yes.
October 29th. We can hardly wait for this. Thank you for wanting to come back to our city.
I can't wait. It's a city of music, is it not? That's what it's all about. You're surrounded by it. You're engulfed by it. You know, you're also engulfed by great faith, something I've noticed about Nashville strongly, and that is its faith. All of those things seemed to come to me at the right at that time of life, after losing my brothers and then having Ricky to support me and his wife, Sharon. And that was a wonderful experience. So that was the time I did the Opry last.
Well, we're looking forward to you coming back. They are very special people. And I'll tell you a couple of other special people, too, in your life. And that's T.G. Shepherd and his beautiful wife, Kelly Lang.
That's absolutely true. And I met Kelly and T.G. straight after the fire, at the same time as I met Ricky, within the same week. And the Oak Ridge Boys, and everybody was so kind and sweet and sympathetic to what had happened, you know. But these things, they're meant to happen. So there's a great reward in us going to Nashville. It was nothing to do with the Cash House in so much as it had much more to do with meeting all those people and falling in love with the music.
Blessings come out of every hardship. I'm convinced of that. I really, really believe that.
Oh, yeah. Everything bad is set up for something good.
That's right. And I know that T.G. Shepherd and Kelly Lang will be appearing on the Opry that night well.
That's right. Kelly and I are going to sing a song. It's a big week for Kenny Rogers, and I think we're going to be there, too, when he gets inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame. And that'll be a pleasure, too. That's a few days before the Opry.
That's a major deal. Kenny Rogers, of course, and Dolly Parton recorded your composition, Islands in the Stream.
That's
a lot of
right.
people may not know that.
That's true.
How does it make you feel when an iconic duo like that records a composition of yours?
Blessed. Blown away. And because in the first place, we didn't think that it was Kenny who came up with that idea, you know. It was he who suggested that it might make a great duet. And it was he who brought it to Dolly Parton. So, you know, thanks to him. Great honor. Great honor.
Well, I know you're also a fan of people like Bobby Bear and Bill Anderson. Bobby
yes,
Bear will be going.
Detroit City and Bill Anderson. All those people, you see, my childhood was Australia. And as a young teenager, that was the music we heard. We didn't hear. I don't think even rock and roll had occurred at that point. I think it was Roy Orbison and Roy Acuff. And that was what rock and roll was to us in Australia. You know,
wow.
Johnny Cash, I Walk the Line, or Teenage Queen, probably about 58.
That's right. Well, you go back to that substance. You know, people are starved for it, and you got a good dose of it. You've got the goods, Barry.
Well,
you've been inoculated, and you've got the pedigree.
Well, you're very kind. But that kind of music, plus Australian music, you know, we were fed on. You know, so I think. Maybe the love of country goes way back to that.
Well, that's a lot of people will be fascinated to learn that. I want to encourage the listener to visit your website, which is barrygibb.com. I know that you maintain a residence in the UK and also in Miami, Florida.
Yes.
And you and your wife both have dual citizenship. You're U.S. citizens. Proud to say that.
That's correct, yes.
Now, do you have any appearances around tied in with this going on here at the Opry?
This is specifically Nashville, and I just finished a bunch of shows in England, so my arms are tired, you know. I had to do this one more thing before Christmas, and then and it'd be a pleasure to see Kenny. It'd be a pleasure to be at the opera again, and then it's Christmas.
It'll be here before we know it.
Yeah, you're right, and Thanksgiving, you know.
I've got to ask you, what's ahead for the future, Barry?
Well, probably a string of shows in the U.S. starting in the spring. But right now we're still putting that together. It'll probably be about 10 shows, 9 or 10 shows. Right now we're working out the routing and how we get from A to B, you know. But for me, it's get me on the stage. Don't leave all the other stuff out, you know. Get me on the stage.
After a 50-year career, is the word retirement in your vocabulary?
No, the term I'll do it till I can't do it is probably more appropriate for me. If my knees don't quit, then my hips might. Something will quit, I know that.
Well, again, Barry Gibb will be appearing at the Tuesday Night Opry on Tuesday, October 29th. If you'd like to get tickets, you better do it because this is going to be a sellout. You can call
61. I heard Larry Gatlin's doing it. He's a very, very dear friend. So I'm looking forward to seeing a whole bunch of us in one place. That'll be fantastic.
Well, it will be. For those who want to come and be a part of this, you can get your tickets by calling 615-871-OPRY. Again, that's 615-871-OPRY. You're logging on to opry.com. And if for some reason you can't make it out in person, you'll hear it live as it happens right over 650 AM WSM, around the world at WSMOnline.com, and also by way of opry.com. Barry, I want to share something else with you before we wrap up.
Right.
And here's something I want you to think about. Nashville is Music City, USA.
Right.
It's home of the Country Music Association, the International Bluegrass Music Association,
right,
the Gospel Music Association,
wow,
the Americana Music Association, the Barbershop Quartet Society,
wow,
has its headquarters here, and
right,
you've got people that are based here from classical,
yeah,
to rock and,
yeah,
everything in between. And
yes,
I want to encourage you to give strong consideration into moving to Nashville, because I truly believe that this community would roll out the red carpet if you move here. And I promise you this, we'll treat you nice so many ways you're bound to like one of them.
Well, that's a wonderful thing to say, and I don't know what to say. I'll do everything I can. I'll do everything. I've got a big family to talk. I've got a big family. I've got to tell everybody, you know, how do you feel about moving to Nashville, you know?
Tell them what I just said. We'll treat them nice so many ways they're bound to like one of them. and if we can't get enough red carpet for just you, why, we'll get it. We'll put in some calls and get some more red carpet for the rest of the clan. How does that sound?
Thank you. You know, that's probably the nicest thing anyone's ever said to me professionally. Thank you, sir.
Well, God bless you, sir. What a privilege it is to know you, and thank you so much for allowing us this rare opportunity to do an interview.
Believe me, I'm proud as punch to be on WSM. That's another thing. You know, that's sacred ground too, is it not?
Well, thank you, sir. We look forward to seeing you at the Opry.
Thank you. I look forward to seeing you too.
All righty. Barry, the iconic Barry Gibb, joining us from his home in Miami here on 650 AM WSM and around the world at WSMOnline.com.